This is the first of our two Datastore sessions. You've already learned about the AppEngine, so we're now discussing this important peripheral service, both in this introductory session, followed by an advanced one. For this introductory core session, it's very basic, like what is a Datastore as well as some internals. We'll talk about how the underlying Bigtable provides the scalability and reliability issue of the Datastore, and finally we'll go beyond theory by covering more practical operations about how to use the Datastore. There are many definitions of the Datastore, but very simply and easy to understand, it's a persistent storage for AppEngine data. Why does AppEngine need to store the data? You've already learned that AppEngine is the framework to run the web application. Its nature is very scalable. Basically, the scalability means that if your application has a surge on the load, it automatically increases the number of instances. So we need some central place to save the data, otherwise this instance and that instance would return different results for the same request. This is not an AppEngine specific problem. If you've worked on other traditional web applications, such as CGI to the more recent PHP, relational databases, and data stores for AppEngine is a counterpart of the relational database, or RDB. So the question is, why don't we use an RDB? Why does Google provide data store instead of using some relational database? The answer is real easy, scalability. So if AppEngine is highly scalable, this data store must also match its scalability. Let's look into database scalability to explain why Google uses Datastore as a database for AppEngine. So let's first compare the Datastore with relational databases. If I look clearly, an RDB supports the following functionality. It includes a table join, flexible filtering, and subqueries. The Datastore supports some of these, but its functionality is limited to the simple filtering and sorting. On the other hand, Datastore is highly scalable and reliable without sacrificing performance. RDBs, however, are really difficult to scale. First, let's look at a server configuration of databases. The server can be a single instance. This is a simple configuration, but here the performance of the system is limited by hardware resources of the machine, and it's going to be the single point of failure. If we have replication or copies, it increases the reliability. But here arises the issue of consistency among all server instances. We can also shard. Now, shard means split the server or data into multiple machines so that the multiple machines all together work as one machine. If we shard the database, we often must look for transactions which will become more complicated. Let's talk about consistency, which I'm going to use a lot. Consistency can have two levels, strong or eventual. Strong consistency means that the data is always consistent, whatever happens, into whatever server to query. When write operation is finished, data is already consistent among all servers. Or if a server fails in the middle of a write operation or in the middle of whatever operation, all servers return the same result. Eventual consistency indicates that data will eventually be consistent, but we have a certain time frame in where data is not consistent. DNS, our domain name service, is a good and easy to understand example of eventual consistency. DNS is thought of as a worldwide distributed database system. When you update a configuration on your domain, it's not reflected to all DNS immediately. For a certain period of time, some DNS servers return old configurations and others return the new configuration. But eventually, all DNS servers return the new configuration. A traditional RDB ensures strong consistency. This is the reason why it's hard to ensure scalability without sacrificing performance in RDB, and the reason why Google pursued another solution, Datastore, for AppEngine. Datastore is based on Bigtable, which is a super high scalability underlying technology used throughout Google. And Bigtable is a key for Datastore to secure scalability. So we'll spend some time to look into Bigtable and how it achieves it. So this is the Bigtable. It's a mechanism to offer scalability to the Datastore. So what is a Bigtable? Bigtable is a scalable, distributed, highly available, and structured storage. So the key thing here is a Bigtable is not a database by itself. It doesn't support the query. So it's storage of the data. It has strong consistency for a single row. And I think the best part is it's being used throughout Google for more than 7 years, and it's used by web search, YouTube, analytics, and many other projects throughout. This is a pretty picture about how the Bigtable scales and is really the key of scalability. Take a close look at one shard of data in the Bigtable tablet, which is just the name of the server. So this shard, this tablet server, has many write requests. It has so many write requests that it needs to multiply, and then we have two sets of tablet servers. So then the load is distributed into two servers, two tablets, and this happens automatically, so you don't really need to care about whether you need to increase the number of servers or tablets. This is the Bigtable data model. Big data is data storage, and it's a key value data storage. So here in Bigtable, we call a value as columns. And internally, in those, the data is sorted by a key order, key in lexical order. And the facts are sorted by key to enable the range query by the application. Application means the user of the Bigtable. Here is one Bigtable support. Bigtable supports CRUD. Now that's create, read, update, and delete operations on our own. And it's strong consistency, but not multiple rows. And the support scans by range of keys. So in this example, we're retrieving the rows with prefix B. You want B to be 3. Or in the second example, you can get rows with keys ranging from B to D. So this is what Bigtable can do. But what Bigtable can't do is search by column values. So you can't get column or rows where the column has certain values. This is a limitation of Bigtable. Yes, this is a Google solution for the data store. It's actually how we secure with scalability, reliability, and performance. So the scalability is based on Bigtable automated sharding. Bigtable applications are reliable. It ensures access to your data if the server is down. And Megastore supports transactions, which offer you the strong consistency. Finally, performance, reducing the lock granularity, and allows co-location of the data, so during the transaction, the data you need can be safe in one shard, so that drastically reduces the necessity of the communication be with the shard. This is a big difference from the relational database. This is how you know Google achieves these three. This is the internals of the data store. Let's move on to the actual usage part, the practical part. The Datastore and RDB use different terms for the same corresponding concepts. For example, the category of the object, which type of the object. It is a kind in Datastore versus a table in RDB. And the one entry of the data is an entity instead of a row. And the unique identifier of a file is a key in both. The individual data in the entity is called the property instead of the field in RDB. Perhaps this real example will be easier to understand. Here's an example application of a blog with social features. We have two kinds of data here, a blog entry and a user. Each key is unique with one blog entry and two users. These are called entities. The property is the actual data you want to store in the data store. So in this example, the blog entry, the name, message, and date are the properties. Note user Joe has two followers, and the property has multiple values here. It's different from an RDB structure where we use two tables, one for user and another for relations of users. Also, Joe has no followers, which is also valid. Datastore allows us to have multiple data for one property. And it also allows the empty data like this. So this is the other big difference from RDB. This is a more practical example about how we create an entry or entity in a Java low-level API. The point is we first create an entity Java object. Then we set properties. And finally, we put this Java object into the data store with this put function, which actually communicates with the data store, and it saves the data. This same pattern is used in Python. First create a Python object, then set properties, either by giving values to constructor or by setting values afterwards, and lastly put saves the data into the data store. These are only some examples of the low-level APIs in both Java and Python. We actually have various kinds of APIs, and also some third-party frameworks for Java you can choose from. You might want one with a standard API providing you with more portability, or one with more functionality like caching, or another to use more high-level APIs. We might introduce new APIs, so some APIs might be deprecated. It can change from time to time. The most important thing to remember from this lesson is the Datastore is a highly scalable and highly reliable database that Google offers for AppEngine. Finally, here are some more documents you may want to refer to for more details.